Hub the past few years. I will start by sharing my screen. Let me see if you... I think you need to allow me to share the screen because it says it's disabled.
Is it working now?
Yep, it's working. Thank you. Yes, okay, here. I hope you see this.
Yes, I can see.
Now. Great. So thanks again. It's really a pleasure and an honor. Thanks for the very kind introduction. I'm going to be talking today, as I said, about some work that we are doing in the lab the past couple of years. I'm going to be presenting some published results, but mostly unpublished data, which concerns a main question that we want to address in the lab, which is how neurons maintain their homeostasis over extended periods of time. This is the scientific question. And why is this interesting, at least in the context of neuronal physiology? Well, neuronal cells are, as you know, among the most long-lived cells in our bodies. Some of these cells will actually be born before we're born and will die even after our death. So they will survive for tens of years, even more than 100 years. So they will need to maintain their homeostasis for such a long period of time. They will need to be able to detoxify themselves and maintain a function as it is required for them throughout the life of a human or an animal. So they are facing unique challenges. They are long-lived, as I said, but at the same time, they are also very energy-demanding cells. Just for them to support their functions, they require huge amounts of energy. So they depend a lot on their mitochondria to generate this large amount of energy. And this is actually what prompted our interest. Since they depend a lot on mitochondria, they must have mechanisms to maintain long-term mitochondrial function. And we know that is very difficult because mitochondria, in addition to energy, also produce byproducts of metabolism, the so-called reactive oxygen species. And these reactive oxygen species cause damage to mitochondria. And there has to be a mechanism that constantly maintains mitochondrial integrity and function, especially in neurons. Because neurons are, as you know, post-mitotic, they will need to survive for long periods of time. We don't have renewal through cell division, as we have in other cell types. And because of the unique physiology and morphology of neurons, we actually need to have a very active homeostatic system. So we were then interested in addressing the question of how mitochondrial homeostasis is maintained long-term in neuronal cells. And what actually makes this even more relevant is that in the context of pathology of the nervous system, for example, in neurodegenerative diseases such as Alzheimer's disease, what we see as a prominent feature is mitochondrial dysfunction and an accumulation of non-functional mitochondria in these neuronal cells, as you can see here. So accumulation of mitochondria, dysfunctional mitochondria, has actually been associated with a lot of pathologies, not just Alzheimer's disease, but also many other pathologies, such as, for example, Huntington's disease, Parkinson's, diabetes, type 2, cancer, etc. Many of these pathologies are themselves associated with aging, the process of aging. It is becoming relevant to address the question of how mitochondrial homeostasis is maintained, even in the context of pathology. And this is not a characteristic of just pathological conditions or diseases. It is also a characteristic that we see during normal aging as part of the process of aging itself. So if we, for example, compare young rats versus old rats, what we see happening in most of their tissues is that there is accumulation of mitochondria. There is actually uncontrollable runaway accumulation of mitochondria, as you can see here. If you compare 6 months to 24 months of age, this is rat ventricular tissue, but we see also in other tissues this phenomenon taking place. As you can see, there is accumulation of mitochondria. We can even count mitochondria under the electron microscope in this case. Now, this phenomenon is not just happening in mammals. It also happens in other organisms, even in nematodes, in the lowly nematode Cynorhabditis elegans. And we can actually even monitor this phenomenon in vivo, in real time, by using fluorescent reporters. Such fluorescent reporters are GFP based, and we can even send this fluorescent protein to be localized in the mitochondrion, and we can examine the accumulation of mitochondria in different cell types by using cell type specific promoters. So we can do this in vivo. We don't need to sacrifice animals to make samples that we can then observe under the electron microscope. Here we can just use a fluorescence microscope, and we can observe this accumulation happening in real time through life, and we can even quantify this. For example, here you see comparing day 1, day 3, day 5, day 10. This is already quite old for these animals that live for about 15 days. So you see that there is an increase in fluorescence. This actually signifies an increased number of mitochondria, because remember, this GFP specifically localizes in mitochondria, otherwise it becomes degraded. And we are monitoring, in this case, rat ventricular tissue. So there is a significant increase of mitochondria during aging.
So, Dr. Tabernara, yes, I am sorry. There's some questions that start to come up. Uh-huh. So would you prefer to write them down or stop and answer as you go? Which one is more convenient for you?
It's up to you. It's whatever you prefer. For me, it's fine both ways.
Okay, well, I'll just go, since I interrupted anyways, I'll just... Uh-huh. So there's a question from Dr. Pavlos Neofidou. The question is, which marker do you use to stain in mitochondria?
So as I said, in this case, it's a GFP. It's a fluorescent protein that contains a mitochondrial localization signal. And we can send this reporter to be expressed in any tissue we like using any tissue-specific promoter or cell-specific promoter. In this case, we use a promoter that directs the expression of the mito-GFP reporter specifically in the intestine. And that's how we can monitor mitochondrial accumulation in the intestine specifically. But we can use a neuronal promoter and send this GFP to be expressed in neurons or in muscles, in any type of cell.
I see.
Using such fluorescent reporters allows us to monitor longitudinally the accumulation of mitochondria. Since we don't need to sacrifice the animals, we can always monitor the same animal at different time points, as we do here. And we can compare, for example, day 1 to day 10, there is significant increase in the accumulation of mitochondria. Now, this suggests, I'm showing you this slide to make the point that the phenomenon of mitochondrial accumulation during aging is an evolutionarily conserved phenomenon. It happens both in nematodes and in mammals, distant taxa, in this case, very, very different organisms, which suggests that the mechanisms that are actually underlying this phenomenon might also be conserved, the molecular mechanisms that bring about mitochondrial accumulation during aging might also be evolutionarily conserved. That means we can study these mechanisms in a simple model, such as C. elegans, and then hope that we will be able to extract conclusions that will be valid for other organisms, such as mammals, primates, even humans. Why? Because, as you know, in biology, most fundamental phenomena are evolutionarily conserved, and we can even exchange proteins between very different organisms that will maintain their function. So, for example, we can use human proteins to complement deficiencies in C. elegans and vice versa. So we can use C. elegans proteins and replace human proteins in cell culture, and they will function if we are talking about fundamental, highly conserved mechanisms, such as, for example, mitochondrial function. So that is what prompted us to use the nematodes in Arabidopsis elegans to dissect this, this phenomenon. But what made it even more interesting is actually the following. As I told you already, in wild-type animals, under normal conditions, during aging, we have accumulation of mitochondria. And in this case, we can monitor mitochondrial accumulation again in vivo throughout the animal, not in a tissue or cell-specific manner, but throughout the whole animal by using mitochondrial-specific dyes, such as, for example, in this case, Mitotracker Red is a dye that accumulates specifically in mitochondria, and we can use it to visualize, to stain mitochondria. In this case, what we see is that in wild-type animals, there is accumulation of mitochondria, as normally would be expected. But in mutants, in C. elegans mutants, that we know are long-lived, and there are such mutants in C. elegans, as you may know, aging is a process that has been studied genetically and molecularly in C. elegans, and we have a whole arsenal of tools and mutations and strains that show altered aging properties. In this case, this strain is a DAF2 mutant strain. DAF2 is a gene that encodes the insulin IGF-1 receptor in C. elegans. Now, animals that carry mutations in this insulin receptor are long-lived, which means that they live much longer than wild-type animals, actually twice as long, or in some cases even three times as long. So these animals are long-lived, and what we observed is that they don't accumulate mitochondria. Similarly, another mutant strain that is long-lived, DAF7, DAF7 encodes the TGF-beta of C. elegans, and these animals that carry mutations in their TGF-beta gene are long-lived again. They live about twice as long as wild-type animals. Again, these animals that are long-lived don't accumulate their mitochondria. So here, immediately, we can become suspicious that maybe there is a connection between mitochondrial accumulation and the process of aging itself. Under normal conditions in wild-type animals, we have accumulation of mitochondria, but in long-lived mutants, there's no accumulation of mitochondria, which suggests that maybe there's some link between mitochondrial accumulation and longevity, lifespan. So how do we address this question? How do we find out whether or not such a relationship exists? In C. elegans, it's something that we can actually do because we can manipulate the genome of the animal, which means we can introduce mutations at will at specific points in specific genes. So there are ways actually in C. elegans to alter, to control the number of mitochondria in cells. So if there is a causative relationship between accumulation of mitochondria, the number of mitochondria, and aging, that would mean that if we are able to interfere and regulate somehow the number of mitochondria, that would have as a consequence a difference in lifespan, a difference in longevity. And this is exactly something that we can do in C. elegans by introducing specific mutations to mitochondrial proteins called prohibitins. It doesn't. It is not relevant what these proteins do at this point. We just use them as a means to manipulate the number of mitochondria in cells. So if we downregulate the expression of these proteins, what we do in wild-type animals is, as you can see here, we exacerbate the accumulation of mitochondria. We make things even worse in wild-type animals by mutating these proteins. However, in long-lived mutants, actually, downregulating these proteins causes the exact opposite effect. It further suppresses the number of mitochondria in cells. It further reduces the accumulation of mitochondria during aging. Same thing in a DAF7 mutant. And you can see this by using MitoTracker Red, for example, to stain these animals. And then we can ask what happens to the lifespan of these worms. Is it altered? How is it altered? And indeed, what we see is that whenever we enhance the accumulation of mitochondria, as we did in the wild-type background, what we find is that we shorten lifespan. These are survival curves, and what you see here depicted is actually the number of animals, the number of animals in a population in a certain period of time. So we monitor, let's say, a population of 100 animals, and we see how it's reduced through time. And this is a typical survival curve for wild-type animals. We have a mean lifespan of about 20 days, let's say, a maximum lifespan of about 35 days. And you see that downregulating these two genes, which causes further accumulation of mitochondria, as you saw in the previous slide, let me bring it back again. You see here, there is exacerbation of mitochondrial accumulation. Under these conditions, we have shortening of lifespan. We get the exact opposite in the long-lived mutants. These mutants are long-lived, as you see, but we further extend their lifespan by suppressing the accumulation of mitochondria. So it appears that there is a causative relationship between the number of mitochondria and longevity. And to just summarize this conclusion, enhancing the accumulation of mitochondria would shorten lifespan, whereas the opposite, blocking the accumulation of mitochondria, reducing the number of mitochondria in cells, actually would promote longevity. This is the conclusion from, this is just a preliminary conclusion from this set of experiments. Now, the question becomes then, what is the mechanism, what mechanism controls the number of mitochondria in cells? And of course, you can imagine that there are two processes that actually have some relevance to the regulation of the number of mitochondria in cells. On one hand, there is mitochondrial biogenesis. It's the process that creates new mitochondria, fresh mitochondria. And on the other hand, there is mitochondrial degradation, the process of mitochondrial turnover, of mitochondrial destruction. Now, these two processes, as you can imagine, are well balanced in young animals, in young cells. And actually, they can even be differentially regulated to adjust the number of mitochondria on the physiological conditions. If there is a lot of energy demand, then the number of mitochondria can increase temporarily, transiently. If there is no high energy demand, or if there is no nutrients, if there are no nutrients in the environment, in the medium, then the number of mitochondria can become reduced in cells. And this transiently alters this balance. But there is always a balance. The balance returns to a point where we have equal rate of mitochondrial biogenesis and mitochondrial degradation. Because if we did not have an equal rate, you can imagine we would have a flooding of mitochondria in the cell in one case, or a depletion, a complete depletion of mitochondria in the other. While there is this balance exists in young, well-functioning cells, what we see is that the balance is distorted, is actually collapsing during aging or under conditions where we have age-associated pathologies. And in that case, we end up with runaway accumulation of mitochondria. So we want to understand what is actually causing this shift from the balanced condition to the unbalanced condition. And again, you can imagine that this could happen either by increasing mitochondrial biogenesis or decreasing mitochondrial degradation or a combination of both. But what is it? What is actually causing this runaway accumulation of mitochondria during aging and in age-associated pathologies? Now, to address this question in C. elegans, we can do genetic screenings. We can ask what genes are involved in this mechanism that maintains mitochondrial homeostasis during aging. And we can use clever ways to conduct our genetic screenings so that we identify rare mutants that are actually harboring mutations in genes that are involved in this homeostasis. And in this case, we did such a screening using DAF2 mutants that we know have enhanced homeostasis. We mutated genes that would destroy this homeostasis enhancement, would bring back homeostasis down to the wild type situation where we don't have long-term homeostasis, and we see accumulation of mitochondria during aging. And using this criterion as a screening, we can very easily identify mutants that have altered mitochondrial homeostasis, meaning that they accumulate their mitochondria, and as a result, they are more red if we stain them with MitoTracker Red. So we can very easily distinguish such mutants. Now, by doing this screening, we can either use forward genetics, which means that we randomly mutate the genome using a mutagen such as EMS, for example, ethyl methanosulfate, or we can go in a targeted manner and knock down each and every gene in the genome using genome-wide RNAi library screening. This is something we can do very easily in C. elegans. All genes, all 20,000, approximately 20,000, 21,000 genes, we can knock down individually using specific RNAi constructs. And this allows us very easily to screen the genome and identify genes that are involved in mitochondrial homeostasis. So I'm not going to go through the details of how this screening was done technically. I'm just going to summarize what we found. We recovered genes out of this screening that are involved in a process called mitophagy. Specifically, what we identified is mitophagy mediators. Such mediators bear names such as DCT1, NIX. This is a mitophagy receptor. PINK is a serine threonine kinase that regulates mitophagy, and parking is an E3 ubiquitin ligase that again is one of the regulators of mitophagy. So the recovery of these genes out of the screening suggested to us that mitophagy might be a process that is actually involved in maintaining mitochondrial homeostasis during aging. Now, what is mitophagy? Mitophagy is a specific type of autophagy, as you might guess from the name. It's a type of macroautophagy, to be more precise, that is specific for mitochondria. The cargo for degradation is mitochondria. Now, how does this happen? Actually, mitophagy was first characterized and described in yeast And there, yeast cells carry out mitophagy when they are found in an environment that's devoid of nutrients. There are no nutrients in the medium. Then that means that these cells are starving. There's nothing to burn, so they don't need a lot of mitochondria. In addition, they need to somehow find nutrients to maintain their function, to survive through prolonged starvation conditions. So what do? They carry out, among other things, they carry out mitophagy. They degrade most of their mitochondria. They reduce their mitochondrial content. How is this done? We have the formation of the autophagosome, which is a double vesicle, double membrane vesicle that forms around the mitochondrion. And this happens because of the interaction of proteins on the outer membrane of mitochondria with proteins that are on the outer membrane of the nascent autophagosome. And this directs the formation of the autophagosome around the mitochondrion. The mitochondrion is engulfed. And then it's delivered to the lysosome for degradation. So we have the autophagosome forming specifically around a mitochondrion through the interaction of these proteins. ATG32 is one such protein on the mitochondrial surface, interacts with ATG8 either directly or via a bridge called ATG11 in this case. And this results in the encapsulation of the mitochondrion in the autophagosome, and then the fusion of the autophagosome with the lysosome for degradation. And that's how yeast cells reduce the number of mitochondria under conditions of starvation. And of course, because of this degradative event here in lysosomes, new nutrients are generated that are then used to sustain life of cells under starvation. And this is a paradigm of mitophagy under conditions of starvation, of stress. And it's a physiological homeostatic response. Another paradigm of mitophagy is that happening in our erythrocytes. Now, in erythrocytes, we have complete destruction of mitochondria during maturation to red blood cells. As you know, red blood cells are enucleated. They don't have a nucleus, but they also don't have any mitochondria. The reason being that you don't want to have mitochondria in a cell that carries oxygen. As you know, mitochondria consume oxygen, so we don't want to have mitochondria in a cell that needs to transport oxygen to tissues. Besides, these cells are short-lived and they have enough energy for the short lifespan. They don't need mitochondria. And very wisely, evolution has actually made it so that these cells clear their mitochondria using mitophagy. In this case, again, mitophagy proceeds exactly the same compared to yeast. We have LC3, which is a homolog of ATG8 on the autophagosomal membrane, and then Nix, which is similar to ATG32. This is the mitophagy receptor, and the interaction of these two proteins directs the formation of the autophagosome around the mitochondrion for degradation. And again, this is a physiological paradigm of mitophagy. Now, there is also mitophagy that is caused by pathological conditions. And what are these pathological conditions? Whenever we have a damaged mitochondrion, damaged mitochondria are not functioning well. Instead of producing ATP efficiently, they actually produce a lot of reactive oxygen species, a lot of byproducts of metabolism. And this causes the degradation of specifically of those mitochondria by labeling them through a mechanism that involves pink. So pink becomes activated in the vicinity of a damaged mitochondrion. This results in the activation of parking and ubiquitin. And instead then, subsequently then, parking ubiquitinates specific proteins on the mitochondrial surface. and this acts as a flag for the formation of the autophagosome around the damaged mitochondrion specifically. And then we have the degradation of just the damaged mitochondrion without sacrificing functional fresh mitochondria. Now, what happens when we cannot really perform mitophagy properly in during aging? What we see is that actually in wild type animals, not being able to perform mitophagy properly is not actually causing any effect on lifespan. There's no alteration in the lifespan of wild type animals. This is something that you might be expecting because under wild type conditions, mitophagy is not upregulated. But in mutants where that are long-lived, for example, in DAF2 mutants, that, as I told you already, don't accumulate their mitochondria, which means that mitophagy is upregulated in those mutants, downregulation of mitophagy is actually taking away part of their longevity. This suggests that one of the reasons that these animals live long, DAF2 mutants live long, is because they have activated mitophagy. And if we now go and downregulate this mitophagy, we limit their longevity. The same thing, this is something we can do specifically for mitophagy by knocking down DCT1. DCT1 is the homolog, as I said, of Nix, which is a mitophagy receptor. So downregulation of DCT1 specifically downregulates mitophagy, not other types of autophagy. That is a good tool if we want to specifically manipulate mitophagy without influencing, actually sparing other types of autophagy. In this case, downregulation of DCT1 shortens the lifespan of long-lived DAF2 mutants. Same thing with PINK1. PINK1 is the serine threonine kinase that is a regulator, an upstream regulator of mitophagy. And again, we have shortening of lifespan of DAF2 mutants. And we have no effect in wild-type animals that have only basal levels of mitophagy. This might seem something to be expected, but it is actually a paradox, and I'm going to tell you in a while why this is a paradox. But first, let me now focus on the nervous system, because remember the question was what is the mechanism that is responsible for the maintenance of long-term homeostasis in neuronal cells. Now, in C. elegans, we actually have a very well-characterized nervous system. We can do this kind of studies because we know exactly how many neuronal cells are there, just 302 neurons. We even know the connectome. We know how these neurons are connected to each other, and we can even draw the whole circuit of the C. elegans nervous system down to single synapses. So it is actually a very well characterized nervous system where we can conduct precise measurements of mitochondrial number in specific neuronal cells. Now, when we downregulate mitophagy, what we see happening in the neurons of C. elegans is that there is accumulation, pronounced accumulation even of mitochondria. We have a lot more mitochondria in neuronal cells if we downregulate mitophagy specifically, for example, by knocking down DCT1 or PINK or parking. It's called PDR1 in C. elegans. We have a lot more mitochondria, but we don't just accumulate mitochondria. We are actually causing mitochondrial dysfunction. What we see happening upon mitophagy downregulation is that there is an increase in ROS production. There is leakage of calcium from mitochondria, which signifies mitochondrial dysfunction. That's when mitochondria leak calcium, when there is a problem in their function. There is a collapse of the inner mitochondrial membrane potential that is used to generate ATP by the respiratory chain. And as a consequence, we have reduction of ATP production. So we have actually a phenomenon of mitochondrial aging if we interfere with mitophagy. Young mitochondria produce a lot of ATP and very few free radicals, ROS, but as mitochondria age, we have less ATP production and a lot of ROS being generated. Now, because of this, cells that are not capable of performing mitophagy are actually experiencing oxidative stress, are under strong oxidative stress. Now, neurons, because they need to survive for long periods of time, they need to be able to cope with oxidative stress, as you can imagine. They need to be able to defend themselves against oxidative stress. And how do they do this? How do neurons cope with oxidative stress? Well, what they do is they actually cleanse themselves of damaged mitochondria. Usually mitochondria are well distributed in neurons, as you can see here, throughout the axon. We have mitochondria that are dispersed throughout the axon. Mitochondria are found in synapses, in the cell soma, in various appendages of neurons. But if we stress neurons, for example, using paraquat, paraquat is a herbicide that generates oxidative stress, generates free radicals, or by mutations that are affecting the respiratory chain, and as a result, we have increased ROS production. What we see happening in these neuronal cells is that they reduce their number of mitochondria as a way to compensate. So if there is a lot of oxidative stress, if these cells sense that there is oxidative stress, they immediately initiate a response of cleansing themselves of damaged mitochondria or of mitochondria that are generating ROS. We see that they are transporting this mitochondria to the soma, where most of the degradation takes place. And this process is actually triggered by calcium that leaks out of the damaged mitochondria. So how do neuron cells realize, how do they sense that there is accumulation of mitochondria? They sense this because of the elevation of calcium concentration in the cytoplasm that occurs after the leakage of calcium from mitochondria. So calcium is important. We can actually interfere and chelate calcium. In this case, if we use a calcium chelator to absorb calcium, we blind neurons. They are not able to see that there is accumulation of mitochondria, so they don't mount a cleansing response. They don't really reduce the number of mitochondria. And this pathway, as again, you might suspect, involves kinases that are responsive to calcium, such as the AMP kinase and the calcium calmodulin dependent protein kinase 2. These kinases become activated by calcium elevation, and as a result, they trigger the retrograde transport of mitochondria to the soma. And in addition to the transport of mitochondria to the soma, they also trigger the induction of mitophagy. So we see that mitophagy is upregulated under conditions of oxidative stress in neurons specifically. And this happens through the AMPK calcium calmodulin protein kinase 2 axis. Now, if we arrive at a situation where these neurons need to upregulate mitophagy because they are experiencing oxidative stress, but they cannot do so, for example, because we depleted them of a specific mitophagy regulator, such as DCT1 in this case, so they cannot really perform mitophagy as they should. What we see is that mitochondria are actually accumulating. The neurons are becoming incapable of cleansing themselves of damaged mitochondria. So damaged mitochondria accumulate in these neurons. And of course, this has detrimental consequences for these neuronal cells. Neurons become highly vulnerable, highly sensitive to neurodegeneration. For example, we can see this by using a model of Parkinson's disease in C. elegans, where we overexpress human alpha-synuclein specifically in dopaminergic neurons of C. elegans. And as you can see here, we cause the generation of these neurons to some extent. But look what happens if, on top of that, we downregulate mitophagy. Essentially, these cells are becoming defenseless. They now degenerate to a much greater extent because they cannot perform mitophagy. So mitophagy is a protective mechanism that, when is not there, when is inhibited, actually sensitizes neurons to, you know, neurodegeneration because of overexpression of an aggregation-prone protein such as alpha-synuclein. In another paradigm of neurodegeneration, that of Alzheimer's disease, where two proteins have been implicated, tau and beta amyloid, what we actually see is that accumulation of these proteins, tau or beta amyloid, in neurons strongly inhibits mitophagy. So if a neuron is accumulating tau or beta amyloid, this neuron is actually not capable of performing mitophagy to normal levels anymore. And again, as a consequence, this sensitizes these neurons for neurodegeneration. So in the context of two diseases, Parkinson's and Alzheimer's disease, we see that mitophagy is implicated as a pro-survival mechanism. And in both scenarios, what we find is that mitophagy inhibition actually sensitizes these neurons. And in the case of Alzheimer's disease, the downregulation of mitophagy is actually caused by the tau and beta amyloid proteins themselves. So these neurons show much lower levels of mitophagy. And we've even confirmed these findings in humans. We first observed this in C. elegans, that tau and beta amyloid accumulation inhibits mitophagy. But this is also happening in humans, because in post-mortem brains of Alzheimer's disease patients, we see that the common feature of those individuals is much repressed mitophagy activity. So indeed, it appears that mitophagy is contributing as a mechanism of pathogenesis when inhibited in Alzheimer's disease. Now, what I've told you up until now concerns pathological conditions. So mitophagy is really a pro-survival mechanism when neurons face challenges, such as, for example, accumulation of aggregation-prone proteins. But what about the physiological function of neurons? Is mitophagy required for the physiological function, for the day-to-day physiological function of neurons? It seems that indeed mitophagy is playing a very important role. For example, in this case, we are using a learning and memory paradigm in C. elegans, where we can alter the behavior of animals by exposing them to different chemical substances that are normally chemoattractants. So these animals are actually able to chemotax towards certain chemicals, such as sodium chloride, for example, or isoamyl alcohol. This is an innate behavior they have immediately after they are born. It's actually hardwired in their nervous system to like these chemicals. It's, let's say, their firmware to like sodium chloride and isoamyl alcohol, because these chemicals signal the presence of food. Sodium chloride is found in environments where bacteria grow. That's why we actually use sodium chloride to grow E. coli in a VLB. And isoamyl alcohol is produced by fermentation that is caused by bacteria. So naturally, C. elegans likes these chemicals because they predict food. But we can train animals to not like these chemicals if we pair them with starvation. So if we starve animals in the presence of these chemicals, then of course animals, even C. elegans, can learn a few things, a few tricks. And one of the things that C. elegans can be taught is to avoid chemicals that predict starvation. And you see this by calculating the chemotaxis index. Wild-type animals strongly chemotax towards isoamyl alcohol. In this case, this is an experiment with isoamyl alcohol. So they strongly chemotax towards isoamyl alcohol. But if we train them by exposing them to isoamyl alcohol under starvation, what we see is that the chemotaxis index becomes negative, which means that not only they are not chemotaxing towards, but they actively avoid going towards isoamyl alcohol. This is a typical behavioral plasticity paradigm. It's like Pavlovian learning, associative learning, and the same mechanisms, long-term potentiation, long-term depression are playing a role here. I'm not going to go into these details, just on the behavioral plasticity aspect. Now, if we inhibit mitophagy by downregulating these mitophagy mediators, what we see is that now these animals, although they do alter their behavior, they now don't like isoamyl alcohol as much, they fail to avoid isoamyl alcohol under conditions of starvation. So, which means that they don't learn as well. So mitophagy is actually required even for physiological behaviors such as learning and memory. And we can even manipulate this capacity by regulating the levels of mitophagy. I've told you up until now about down-regulation of mitophagy, basically by knocking down mitophagy mediators. But what about actually stimulating mitophagy, increasing the levels of mitophagy? How can we do that? Well, there are a few ways, both genetic and pharmacological. And I'm going to just give you an example in this case. We can use specific compounds such as, for example, urolithin A is a natural compound that is a stimulant, a specific stimulant of mitophagy. Nicotinamide is another activator of mitophagy, specific activator of mitophagy. So we can treat animals using these chemicals, and we can use these chemicals to specifically activate mitophagy. Now, what would happen in a scenario where mitophagy is downregulated because we've overexpressed, for example, tau or beta amyloid? As I've told you earlier, tau and beta amyloid that have been implicated in Alzheimer's disease pathogenesis, when overexpressed, are downregulating mitophagy, are inhibiting mitophagy. What if we now try to restore the levels of mitophagy using such chemicals, urolithin A or nicotinamide? What we find is that actually we can even restore learning deficits that are caused by tau and beta amyloid accumulation, suggesting that we can upregulate mitophagy to counter the effects of the overexpression of these proteins, to counter the deficiencies in learning and memory that have been associated with accumulation of proteins implicated in Alzheimer's disease by just upregulating mitophagy. So this could be a means of intervening to restore normal levels of mitophagy under conditions where we have tau accumulation or beta amyloid accumulation. Now I'm going to finish by coming back to the paradox I mentioned in the beginning. Remember that when we downregulate mitophagy in a wild-type setting, we don't see any effect on lifespan. However, and this would be anticipated somewhat if we thought that mitophagy is not activated in a wild-type background, so not having mitophagy mediators there or downregulating mitophagy mediators there would not really cause any problem. But at the same time, what I've told you is that mitophagy downregulation, even in the wild type context, is causing a host of detrimental effects. So we have accumulation of damaged mitochondria, we have increased ROS production, we have decreased ATP levels, etc. And all these things we would expect would cause some shortening of lifespan, because lifespan is a very sensitive gauge of whatever is going wrong in cells or in the whole organism. But still, you see here, if we compare lifespan of wild-type animals with animals where we have down-regulated mitophagy, there is no difference practically. So something must be compensating. That's what we thought. Something must be compensating for the down-regulation of mitophagy in a wild-type background to maintain normal lifespan. And one candidate process for such a compensation, a compensatory mechanism, is the so-called retrograde response. What is a retrograde response? It's a signaling axis from mitochondria to the nucleus, where most of the mitochondrial protein encoding genes reside, to upregulate mitochondrial gene expression so that we can build new mitochondria. This retrograde response is orchestrated by a transcription factor called PGC1 alpha that works together with a number of cofactors of the NRF family, the nuclear factor erythroid 2 related factors. There's actually some confusion because nuclear related factors are a different family of transcription factors. These are nuclear factor erythroid 2 related transcription cofactors. These cofactors work together with PGC1 alpha to upregulate a host of a whole battery of genes encoding mitochondrial proteins. And this is actually part of the mitochondrial biogenesis process, of the process of creating new fresh mitochondria. Now, in C. elegans, we don't have a PGC1 alpha, but we have a transcription factor called SCN1, which is a member of this protein cofactor family. So we decided to test whether or not actually the retrograde signaling that I've described to you here is involved in compensating under conditions of reduced mitophagy. So what we found is that indeed, under conditions of mitophagy downregulation, SCN1 becomes activated, and in turn, SCN1 upregulates the expression of many genes that encode mitochondrial proteins. These are just some examples here, key respiratory chain proteins. But interestingly, and this is why I'm showing it, we did a whole genome microarray analysis. We identified all targets of SCN1, most of them being mitochondrial proteins. But the interesting thing is that among those targets of SCN1 is DCT1. DCT1 is the mitophagy receptor that we use to downregulate mitophagy itself. So what is happening here, what we actually see, is that when mitophagy is downregulated, a signaling response is triggered that attempts to restore mitophagy by upregulating a key mitophagy regulator, DCT1, the mitophagy receptor itself. So indeed, it appears that we have a feedback loop, a negative feedback loop, where whenever we downregulate mitophagy, cells actually are trying to compensate, are trying to bring back mitophagy to normal levels by upregulating a mitophagy mediator. Now, if we don't have SCN1, that means we cannot engage this feedback loop. It's the feedback loop is broken. And under such conditions, when we don't have SCN1, as you can see here, we have dramatic shortening of lifespan if we downregulate mitophagy. So essentially, without this feedback loop, the organism does not have a way to defend against the downregulation of mitophagy, does not have a way to compensate. And this is then revealed as shortening, dramatic shortening of lifespan if skin 1 is not there. So I will conclude by bringing everything I've told you together in a very simplistic diagram that describes the mechanism I've just talked to you about. It's actually very interesting how nature has found a way to co-regulate two opposing processes, mitochondrial biogenesis and mitophagy, at the same time, whenever cells sense that there are damaged or superfluous mitochondria around. So whenever we have such a condition with damaged mitochondria or excess mitochondria, there are two things that happen. On one hand, we have oxidative stress that is ensuing under these conditions. Now, through a signaling pathway that I didn't describe to you, actually, oxidative stress results in the activation of SCN1. Now, SCN1 is a transcription factor that is responsible for the retrograde response in C. elegans. SCN1 activates mitochondrial biogenesis, so we have generation of fresh mitochondria. At the same time, SCN1 is also activating the expression of DCT1, that is a mitophagy receptor, a critical mitophagy mediator. However, this is not sufficient to induce mitophagy. Another pathway needs to become engaged, the pink parking pathway that becomes activated specifically in the vicinity of damaged mitochondria, which then ubiquitinates. This pathway eventually results in the ubiquitination of DCT1 in specific residues. And this ubiquitinated DCT1 can then function as a flag for the initiation of mitophagy that will take care of the damaged mitochondria specifically. So we have both processes being regulated by the same mechanism, the same core mechanism. And this mechanism interfaces with insulin IGF-1 signaling, either directly because insulin IGF-1 signaling represses SCN1. So under conditions of low insulin signaling, SCN1 becomes de-repressed and the whole pathway initiates. This explains why in mutants that are long-lived, which are insulin IGF-1 deficient, as I showed you in the beginning, we have activation of mitophagy. Because under low insulin signaling conditions, we have the repression of SCN1, activation of the expression of DCT1, which is a prerequisite for mitophagy induction. And this can happen either directly, because it is known that insulin IGF-1 signaling either directly downregulates SCN1 activity, or through DAF16. DAF16 is a transcription factor of the FOXO family of transcription factors that is repressed. Similarly to SCN1, DAF16 is repressed by insulin IGF-1 signaling. Lowering insulin IGF-1 signaling de-represses DAF16, similarly to SCN1, and then DAF16 also upregulates the expression of DCT1. DCT1 is under the control of both these transcription factors, SCN1 and DAF16. And this is a very economical and wisely, if you allow me to say, designed pathway that controls two opposing processes in cells. What I've described to you was found in C. elegans, but the same pathway actually controls mitophagy and mitochondrial biogenesis in mammalian cells, in mice, and most likely even in humans. Now, in neurons, and this is my last slide, mitophagy is playing a pro-survival role. Mitophagy is required for eliminating damaged mitochondria that will be generated throughout the lifespan of neurons. There are always mitochondria that become damaged. So these mitochondria need to be degraded very fast before they damage further the neuron by generating reactive oxygen species. So in this case, mitophagy is a very important pro-survival homeostatic mechanism because it becomes activated, upon sensing that there is mitochondrial damage, and eliminates those damaged mitochondria before they have time to cause any further damage. If mitophagy is not functional in neurons, then these neurons become defenseless against oxidative stress and the accumulation of damaged mitochondria. And as a result, they are sensitized to neurodegeneration. They become much more prone to die, and mitophagy has actually been found to be strongly downregulated in the context of neurodegenerative diseases such as Alzheimer's disease. So I will finish here. I will thank my colleagues and friends here at the Institute of Molecular Biology and Biotechnology in Heraklion. What I presented to you today is mostly the work of Kostas Palikaras, a graduate student who did this project as part of his PhD thesis, and Irini Lionaci, who is a postdoctoral associate in the lab that did most of the proteomics work that was required to identify the ubiquitination events on DCT1 upon activation of mitophagy. Thank you very much for your patience and your attention, and I would be happy to address any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Dr. Tavernarakis, for this wonderful talk. It's amazing to see how complex such a small animal is, despite its 302 neurons. Mm-hmm. So I see we have four questions, and I think whoever wants to ask a question can write it down, and then I can follow to unmute or raise a hand, whatever is easier, so we don't confuse, so we all don't end up speaking at the same time. I think that would be a strategy. Mm-hmm. So I guess let's go with Alexia Alexandraki's questions. She has a few here. Mm-hmm. So the first one is it only accumulation of mitochondria that is observed during aging, or also mitochondria disorganization?
Yeah. So it's actually both. So there are two things that happen during aging. We have accumulation of mitochondria, but actually most of those mitochondria that are accumulating are damaged mitochondria. That's one thing. The other thing is that happens is that the mitochondrial network in the cell becomes disorganized, because we are used to think of mitochondria as isolated organelles, but actually in most cell types, what we see is that there is a mitochondrial syncytium. So there is a whole network of mitochondria that spans the whole cell. Mitochondria are connected to each other. There's always, there's constantly mitochondrial fission and fusion mm-hmm. happening. Now, I didn't go into that direction, but what is actually required for mitophagy is mitochondrial fission. So when mitochondria are connected to each other, they are a poor substrate for mitophagy. So mitophagy requires fission that will isolate the damaged domain, the damaged mitochondrial domain, before it is autophagocytosed, before an autophagosome forms. So an autophagosome cannot form around the syncytium, a large syncytium. First, you need to isolate the part that is damaged, and then take it out by mitophagy. So during aging, we don't just have accumulation, expansion of the mitochondrial network, but we also have misshaping happening, so, which means that the mitochondrial network loses its shape, it loses its integrity, some parts become isolated, become fissioned out, and those parts are the parts that are degraded, the parts that have separated from the syncytium.
So I assume this is controlled by a different network of proteins, yes. Right? So they interact with the mitophagy network.
Yes.
Allow the homeostasis.
Exactly.
Okay. So the next question, and I think I'm not sure if this was answered during the presentation, but is how mitochondria accumulation can promote aging. I guess.
Yeah. So when you have so-called superfluous mitochondria, so cells do not like to have more than what they want. So they will always control the number of mitochondria. If they need more mitochondria, they will build more mitochondria. If they, on the other hand, they don't need mitochondria, they will degrade their mitochondria. So there's always a shifting in the balance to maintain a physiological number of mitochondria in cells, depending on their energy demands. When cells start accumulating their mitochondria, this causes problems because it also means that we will generate more reactive oxygen species. The more mitochondria we have, the more ROS we generate. And this goes to without even considering damaged or non-damaged mitochondria. Even fresh mitochondria, very young mitochondria, will generate ROS. This is a byproduct of metabolism. It's something that we cannot avoid. There's always ROS being generated inside our cells. There's always ROS being generated. But cells have ways of actually coping with this, detoxifying themselves. Now, when we accumulate mitochondria, that means we increase the load of free radicals that cells will need to cope with. And this, of course, poses stress to cells. This is oxidative stress. This is what I've told you about. Oxidative stress is a consequence of mitochondrial accumulation, even if these mitochondria are fully functional fresh mitochondria.
Okay.
And this, of course, is causing aging, because the more oxidative stress you have, that means the more damage you are causing. And aging is essentially accumulation of damage. That is what aging is. That's the substrate of aging. The basis, the molecular basis of aging is damage accumulation. So the more mitochondria you have, the more ROS you generate, the more likely it is that you will suffer some sort of damage. DNA damage, protein oxidation, etc., which contributes to aging.
So it's better to keep them under control.
Yeah.
So the next question is from Christina Dimitriadou. So do you have any clue if in C. elegans wild-type background nutrient availability can epigenetically alter pink, parking, or DCT1? To regulate mitophagy, mitochondrial accumulation, and longevity?
It's a good question, but I have no answer. This is something we haven't done, so I don't know if there are epigenetic changes that would affect these regulators. We haven't really looked at this, so I don't know.
Yes, that was actually a question that I had also with that regards. How does mitochondria homeostasis affect the whole nutrient and metabolism pathways? Because if you change, I assume the mitophagy or the increase in biogenesis of mitochondria, you also increase metabolic pathways.
It's an interesting question, but I have no answer.
Okay, to be seen. Mm-hmm. So the next question is from Father Dr. Dimitrios Mapouras. So the question is there any effect of antibiotics on mitochondria and aging?
I don't know. We haven't really done any experiments specifically to address this question. From the literature, I know that there are some effects of antibiotics to mitochondrial homeostasis. This is not our work, so I'm not really saying this as a result that we did of an experiment that we did in C. elegans. But in the literature, it has been reported that certain antibiotics, actually, there are antibiotics that interfere directly with mitochondrial function. So in that case, it has been reported that indeed we have alteration of mitophagy, and we also have alteration of ROS production and the aging in that context. But I wouldn't really know experimentally anything additional to that.
So I have a question, and it is, you showed GABAergic neurons in the C. elegans. I was wondering if there's a difference in this mechanism between the GABAergic or the other types of neurons, like non-GABAergic. I'm not familiar with C. elegans, if there's any glia cells. There is. Yes. So if there's any difference between these mechanisms, or is it like a global cellular mechanism that applies throughout?
Yes, yes. So we haven't looked at glia cells specifically. We've looked at various neuronal cell types. Dopaminergic neurons, I've shown you already some data on dopaminergic neurons, glutamatergic neurons, etc., interneurons, sensory neurons, motor neurons. We've looked at different types of neurons, and this mechanism is the same throughout. So we are talking about a housekeeping mechanism. It's not just only about neurons, it's also about other cell types. We looked in muscle cells, in epithelial cells. So this homeostatic mechanism I described to you, this pathway that I've shown you here, is actually operating in multiple cell types. It's not specific to neurons. I don't know specifically about glia because we have not really done the experiment with glia cells. There are cells akin to glia in C. elegans, but I wouldn't be surprised if the mechanism was also operating there. Because it is essentially operating in any cell type. It's a housekeeping mechanism.
Interesting. So another question from Alexia Alexandraki. Insulin production facilitates glucose uptake in tissues. Can this explain the fact that when insulin is low, mitochondria biogenesis is promoted, resulting in ATP production for energy consumption?
Well, there are two things that happen. We have mitochondrial biogenesis, but we also have degradation of mitochondria. So what the cell actually wants to do is not to have more mitochondria. The cell wants to have more efficient mitochondria under conditions of glucose deprivation, of nutrient deprivation in general. Having more mitochondria will not solve the problem because there's no more nutrients to burn. What you need is to make better use of the little amount of nutrients that you have, which means that you need to replace whatever inefficient mitochondria you have with fresh ones. That is why you activate both mitochondrial biogenesis and mitophagy under conditions of starvation of low insulin signaling. As you can see in this diagram, under low insulin conditions, we activate mitochondrial biogenesis through this axis, through this pathway here, but we also activate mitophagy. Why is this? We need to take out the mitochondria that are not working efficiently and replace them with fresh mitochondria that are working efficiently in order to make us good use, the best use that we can to the low number amount of nutrients that we have.
So I don't know if anybody else has any questions, but one that comes into mind now is, what's the turnover period for creating versus destroying, I guess, or the mitochondria in a cell? So do they happen at the same time scale?
So yeah, I don't know. it's a good question. We haven't time. I don't think it's even technically possible to follow a specific mitochondrion from birth to death, let's say, and time this, because there's always alteration of identity, let's say. There's always fusion and fission happening, so okay. Mitochondria become fused, then you don't really know which is which, and I don't think it's technically feasible to do this.
Okay. So until we have another question, so has anybody associated the blue zones people, the people that live a long time with any mitochondria function or number? Yeah, yeah.
So again, that's a good question. And indeed, there is some association. There is correlative evidence, let's say, that, of course, there's no proof, but centenarians, people who live more than 90, 100 years old, actually appear to have increased mitophagy levels. So the epidemiological studies that have been conducted in various tissues of these individuals show that, among other things, they have low insulin signaling, and they also have increased mitophagy, which is to be expected. If you exhibit low insulin signaling, then mitophagy is upregulated constantly.
Okay, so we have to get their secrets. And again, we don't have any other questions, so I'll take advantage of that. So how about neural stem cells? Does the same apply for those cells, like in the dedicated neuronal cells?
So now, one, we've done some work with stem cells, not specifically stem cells, mostly embryonic stem cells that can be differentiated to neurons, among other cell types. The question would be if mitophagy contributes to stemness, to the property of these cells, which is immortality, let's say. Now, it appears that this is the case. This is not just our work. It has also been published by other groups that immortal cells and immortal cell lines, such as, for example, cancer cell lines, show increased mitophagy. And we've seen that in embryonic stem cells, this is also the case.
I see. So it's a feature of their fitness, the cancer fitness that they gain with the mutation.
Yes, yes.
That's interesting. So we have a question from Professor Andonis Kermizis. How does mitophagy decline with time? Is it abundance of the mediating factors or defect at their transcriptional level?
Yeah, so there are several things that happen. The first is downregulation of expression. So these genes become less and less expressed. This has been found by doing transcriptomics analysis throughout the lifespan of individuals. What we found is that as we age, the expression of, for example, DCT1, PINK, and PARKING is downregulated. Gradually, we lose capacity to maintain proper levels of the expression of these proteins. The other thing that happens is that the activity of these proteins declines because they become oxidized mostly or modified, such as, for example, there are glycation events, cross links that happen during aging. These proteins accumulate damage that cause them to not function properly. And as a result, we have a decline. Overall, we have a decline of mitophagy during aging. And this is not specific to mitophagy. This is a general phenomenon that concerns all other types of autophagy. Autophagy in general declines during aging. And it is hypothesized that this is a contributing factor to senescent decline. The fact that autophagy is not capable of detoxifying the cell as effectively as during young age.
I see. With regards to that, and with regards to the previous question of the blue zones, is there any way that, I mean, I guess it's an epigenetic regulation if we try to with the lifestyle to regulate the level. So are mitochondria, or is that possible?
Well, I don't know. It could be. It could be that this could be achieved, but we haven't done the experiment, so I don't know the answer.
Okay. So I don't think we have any further questions. So I guess a last one. What are the future goals to your research? How do you see mitochondria aging and study to proceed in the future?
Well, we are the main theme of our research in the lab is neurodegeneration and aging. So we are studying the links between aging and neurodegeneration. mitophagy came out as one such link, I would say in a serendipitous manner, because we recovered through the genetic screening that we did the mitophagy regulators, but we were not really set out to study mitophagy per se. Mitophagy just happened to be one of the mechanisms that we identified. Now, there are other mechanisms that we are studying that are related to other types of autophagy. For example, nucleophagy is one such specific type of autophagy, or chaperone-mediated autophagy, another type of autophagy, different from macroautophagy. But we are mostly interested in this link. And autophagy is one contributing factor. Another contributing factor is signal transduction and the function of the ER, the endoplasmic reticulum. We are also focusing there. We are studying ER stress response, the unfolded protein response, for example, that is happening both in the ER and mitochondria, is another type of phenomenon that we are studying, but all in the context of the link between neurodegeneration and aging.
I see. Well, I think we are at the end of our time, Dr. Tavernarakis. Thank you so much for this wonderful talk and for giving us the honor of participating
in the lecture series.
It was a real pleasure having you. And thank you everybody for participating and joining us today. And I wish you a lovely rest of your day. Thank you again. And thank you.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure for me. It was really an honor and a pleasure for me to be here. I hope I didn't confuse you or make you tired, but if there are any questions, you can always contact me by email.
Thank you so much, Dr. Tavernarakis. It was a real honor for us. Thank you. Have a lovely day.
You too.
Bye, everybody. Thank you.
Have a nice weekend.
You too, Dr. Tavernarakis.